I can't forget what you've done, Lord, for me. They are experiencing problems this morning with the Beulah News segment, but guess what? We're going on. Our deacons will come now with devotion.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. I said, good morning, church. I think about, from my old hometown church in California, the late Sister Elsie Pollard. And every morning, without fail, rain or shine, she would always say, "This is the day that the Lord has made." Not yesterday. Yesterday was all right. We're here. And not tomorrow, because we're not there yet. But this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Amen. Thank you all in advance for standing. Gonna read the scripture coming from the book of Haggai. Amen. First chapter, first through the eighth verse, and it reads as follows. In the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, in the first day of the month, came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet unto Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Hozadak, the high priest, saying, "Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, This people say, the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built." Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, "Is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed house, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Ye have sown much and bring in little. Ye eat, but ye have not enough. Ye drink, but ye are not filled with drink. Ye clothe, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes."
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
"Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways."
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. "Go up to the mountain and bring wood." Amen. "And bring the house, and I will take pleasure in it. And I will be glorified, saith the Lord."
Amen. Amen.
God's word for God's people. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. The hymn said 99, say, "Guide me over thy great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand." Then he go and say, "Bread of heaven. Bread of heaven." I don't know about you this morning, Beulah, but bread of heaven, just feed me till I want no more.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father and our God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for watching over us and protecting us. Thank you for waking us up this morning. Let us see a day that we've never seen before in our life. Lord, somebody got on board in January. If you called their name right now, they wouldn't be here. Somebody announced in February, somebody announced in March. We're in the first Sunday in April of 2024. Somebody still didn't make it this far. Lord,
amen.
We thank you for being God.
Yes.
We thank you for coming in our lives. We thank you for hearing our cry. Lord, we just want to thank you this morning for it. Lord, bless those who are viewing us as we stand this morning and witness your word. Bless our choir this morning. My Father, who will be rendering the music. Go with them and stand by and keep them. Lord, not only that, bless the pastor who will be bringing the word. Continue to strengthen them if it be your will. Lord, bless his wife who is here with him. Bless their four beautiful children this morning. Lord, go with and stand by and keep them, my Father. Lord, we ask that you would bless all the sickness that's in this church this morning, not only here at Beulah, but all over this land this morning.
Yes.
Lord, we ask that you would bless those that are in, who are going through bereavement right now. My Father, go with them, stand by, and keep them. Lord, we ask you would bless our brother and our deacon, Deacon Charles Gibbon, and his family, and his, go with them, stand by them, my Father, to strengthen them, if it be your will. Not only that, my Lord, we ask that you continue to bless Brother Ronnie Smith in the passing of his mother this morning, my Father. Lord, there's others that we could call that we may not know right now, my Father. We ask that you would continue to strengthen them and keep them and be your will. Lord, you know our heart before we even open our mind this morning. Lord, we just want to thank you for what you've done so far. Go up and stand by and keep us, my Father. Not only that, Lord, we ask that you would stand by and keep us and hold us until you got your bloodstained balance this morning. Yes. Lord, we've done all we have. This has been assigned to do down here on this side. We ask that you give us a home somewhere on the other side, a building not made by hand. Go with and stand by and keep us. It's in Jesus' name we do
Jesus
pray.
Name.
And amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Let us stand for our hymn this morning. Glory to his name. We will sing verses 1, 2, and 4 and climax with the chorus.
Let all of the people of God on this wonderful first Sunday in this month of April say amen. We give glory, honor, and praise to our Heavenly Father for gracing us, blessing us, favoring us with this another Sunday to return to the house of the Lord and to engage in that wonderful thing called praise and worship. Brothers and sisters, we have come into this house. We have gathered in His name to worship Him. So the songwriter goes on to say, so forget about yourself and concentrate on Him and worship Him, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We certainly want to take this time and opportunity to welcome all of the members of our beloved Beulah family and all of our wonderful visiting friends who are joining us in worship this morning, along with our online worshipers streaming via Facebook, YouTube, or website. And visitors, amen. We are so happy to have you in the house with us this morning. And we just want to pause right here and ask that all of those who are visiting with us on this wonderful first Sunday morning, you're not a member of Beulah yet, but we would love to have you to join us. And if you would stand right now, amen, amen. All visitors, please stand. Amen. Praise the Lord. We are so happy to have each of you sharing in worship with us on this morning. And our prayer is that you will be blessed as a result of being with us in this worship service. So much so until you will look forward to the next opportunity to return and share with us in worship here at Beulah. God bless you. Amen. I want to say, brothers and sisters, that today we welcome home Alexandria Hart, Ariana Wright, Abigail Wright, the daughter and granddaughter of Brother Alex Wright. Amen. Today and always, we remember the late Brother Alex Wright. Amen. Very quickly, our own beloved Reverend Moody Norris is coming now, amen, to represent the Homeless Street Ministry, amen, of which the late Brother Alex Wright was a faithful, faithful, faithful worker.
Praise the Lord, saints. I didn't know I was going to speak this morning. Pastor Black just handed me the mic. Brother Alex Wright, many of you know him. He used to be right back there, amen, standing tall, ushering with his hand out. He did more than just an usher. He was the president over the Homeless Street Ministry.
Yes.
I first joined as a member. Then I became vice president. And then I became president when he got ill. But he took me to the side and told me everything about feeding the homeless. One thing he told me is give them the best that you have.
Yes.
We gave him the best because he taught me. He said, Brother Moody, we don't give secondhand stuff. We give the best that we have. And when I go out now, because of what he taught me as being the president of the Homeless Street Ministry, sometimes, saints, I got to take a break because it overwhelms me and I got to go in the car and cry. You don't want to see what we see when we go out. I thank God for our pastor for seeing to these people. Amen. We give them clothes, we give them food. Pastor, yesterday we did 100 yesterday. We went to DeKalb County and Atlanta. I had a little girl, so I'll get a real short story. A little girl, it was in the summertime, and we asked her what she wants. She had to be number 3 or 4 years old. She said, do you have a blanket? And I said, baby, it's hot. What do you need a blanket for? She said, it gets cold at night. And we don't carry blankets in the summertime. So I went to my vice president, Brother Ralph Armstrong, and I said, we got to get a blanket. He said, we don't have any. He said, but let me go check my truck. And lo and behold, the blanket was sitting in his truck. The little girl took the blanket and held it tight and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. This church does great for the homeless street ministry. Amen. Pastor, this is in honor of Alex Wright that we're going to hang this downstairs, right? This is something that Homeless Street Ministry has started, but we put everybody's name on there that he was a part of. But we want to give this to Pastor Black and the deacons to hang downstairs. So, Sister Alexander, I know you out here somewhere. This is to your father. Can you stand, please, and your children? This is his daughter right there and his grandchildren. We want you to know we're going to hang this downstairs. This is the second plaque we gave away. We gave the first plaque away to Beaufort Baptist Church. When they heard about Brother Alex and the things we were doing, Pastor, they came in with us, and they donated half the stuff for all the women. And we gave the plaque to them first because they served what Alex did. But this one is for Beulah Missionary Baptist Church. And our pastor's going to, the deacon's going to take it. But we want to say thank you to Pastor Black and the members. Amen. On behalf of Brother Alex Wright. I'm going to say this real fast, and I want to thank my Vice President, Ralph Armstrong. Will you stand up, please? Reverend Edwards, these are part of our officers. They work hard to get this done. We went to pastor and pastor, back and forth with pastor. Then we got with the deacons, and the deacons passed it, and church overwhelmingly passed it. So thank you, church. Thank you, Ralph. Thank you, my best friend in the world, Reverend Edwards. And pastor, thank you, sir. God bless you.
Thank you, Reverend Norris. God bless you. Amen. And we're going to give this to, amen, a member of our trustee board. Amen. If you could come. Amen. Here he comes, Brother DeAndre Moore. Amen. We're going to see that this is him. Amen. In a place where we all will be able to see it. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. We don't want to forget those who have labored faithfully. Not only was Brother Wright a faithful part of the homeless street ministry and provided leadership there, but he worked faithfully with the ushers ministry. Amen. He worked faithfully in other capacities here at Beulah every time there was a funeral. Amen. Brother Wright would be numbered among those. Whether he knew the deceased or not, he would be here in support. We can't, amen, and we shouldn't ever stop, amen, appreciating those who have served so faithfully. Amen. Thank you so much. Brothers and sisters, on this first Sunday, we pause, as we do each first Sunday, to pay special tribute to some special people. On this first Sunday, we want to pay special tribute to all persons who are celebrating birthdays in the month of April. If you're celebrating a birthday in this month of April, will you please stand wherever you are in the sanctuary, on the floor level, on the balcony level? Amen. Happy birthday to each one of you. And may the Lord bless you with many, many more yet to come. Amen. Also, on this day, we want to recognize some more special people, those who are celebrating wedding anniversaries in this month of April. Will you please stand wherever, whomever you may be? Amen. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. And we pray that our Heavenly Father will favor you with many, many more wonderful anniversaries yet ahead. Brothers and sisters, Tuesday, April 9th at 7 p.m., we will be going over to the Israel Baptist Church to share with them, to fellowship with them. Amen. And the ministry, deacons, music ministry, ushers, nurses, and the entire church family is invited to go over with us as we share with the pastor, the officers, and the members of Israel Baptist Church in a one-night revival. Amen. They have requested that we would come and be, amen, the special guests for this one-night revival service. And that will start again at 7 p.m. And we are asking the church family, those who possibly can, to join us over there at Israel. Amen. And we certainly want to keep Israel in our prayers. Amen. We all miss the Reverend Dr. William Smith. Amen. He was my pastor. Amen. And certainly he is missed by so many of us. But let's go over and continue the spirit of fellowship with the officers and members and pastor of Israel Baptist Church in a one-night revival. Again, that's Tuesday, this coming Tuesday at 7 p.m. God bless you. Amen. We also want to make mention of the fact that on Sunday, April 14th, we will fellowship with the New Seasons Transformation Ministries for the first anniversary of our very own Reverend Gary Walker. The service will be held at the Oconee County Civic Center in Watkinsville, Georgia. The ministers, deacons, music ministry, ushers, nurses, and the entire church family is invited to go with us to Watkinsville to share with Reverend Gary Walker on this special occasion, his first anniversary as pastor, amen, of this wonderful church, amen. We're looking forward to it, amen. And certainly we would love to have you to go with us, those of you who possibly can join us. It would be a blessing to see you in the place. Amen. We want to mention, brothers and sisters, that our prayers are going out continually for the sick and shut in, the bereaved, and the grief-stricken. And we are soliciting your prayers as we go forth in prayer for the sick and the shut in. And we certainly need you to join us in prayer. It's their time now, but it could be ours at any time in the future. Not only are we praying and lifting prayers for our sick and our shut-in, but also for our bereaved and our grief-stricken. Quickly, let me mention Deacon Robert King, amen, who is now in home hospice care. His condition, amen, has declined, and there is a great need for our prayers. Praying for him, but also praying for Sister King, and for praying for her continued strength. Our prayers are also requested for Sister Shirley Persons, the mother, amen, amen. And certainly we are praying for her, amen. She is the mother of one of our very fine ministers here at Beulah. She herself is a member, and we want to keep her in our prayers, Sister Shirley Persons, amen. But also Mother Mary Phillips, amen, both of whom are patients at Piedmont Hospital, the Peachtree Road location. I've been blessed to go out and have prayer with each of them, and they are certainly, certainly soliciting all of our prayers. Our prayers are also needed for Sister Corrine Ross, who is a patient at Emory Hospital, the sister of Deaconess Von Seal Owens. Will you join us in praying for Sister Donna Morrell Speed, who is a patient at Emory University Hospital, the Clifton Road location. We've had prayer with her, and certainly she needs our prayers greatly. Also, our prayers are requested for Sister Jean Eason, who is at Emory Rehabilitation Center. Let's keep her lifted in our prayers. Also, Sister Ruth Steele and Letitia Robinson, who are both patients at Emory Decatur Hospital. Our prayers are requested also for Sister Rosemary Johnson, who will undergo surgery on the 17th of this month at the Piedmont Hospital, the Peachtree Road location. But also let us remember in prayer the bereaved and grief-stricken. Brother Ronnie Smith is in need of our prayers. Amen. He and his family, during the passing of his mother, who was funeralized on yesterday. Amen. In Warner Robins, Georgia. Our prayers are also needed for Sister Andrea Brown and family during the passing of her late mother. Amen. And a member of Beulah, Sister Louise Lundy Brown. Arrangements at this time are incomplete, but will be forthcoming. Also join us in prayer for Sister Shanita Winslow and family, whose daughter, Desha Winslow, will be funeralized on Friday at the Willie Watkins West End Funeral Home at 12 o'clock noon. And lastly, our prayers are greatly needed for Sister Sonia Williams and family, whose mother and a faithful member of Beulah, Sister Angeline Leonard, will be funeralized here on Friday, this coming Friday, at the 11 o'clock hour. There will be a viewing on Thursday from 12 noon until 8 o'clock p.m. at Gregory B. Levitt and Sons Funeral Home, the Flatshoes Parkway location. Amen. We want to keep in prayer also our own beloved Sister Vicki Webb Franklin and family. Let's keep them lifted in our prayers. The family of the late Sister Geraldine Webb, who served faithfully here at Beulah in many capacities in many areas and was funeralized on yesterday. Amen. We will always remember her. Amen. I do want to make mention of the fact that our own Sister Reverend Pat Ficklin was rushed to the hospital this morning. Amen. We don't know the magnitude or the extent of her condition. She was in the emergency room when we received that information. But let's keep Reverend Ficklin in our prayers. Amen. But it's a joy to know that some who have been removed from us due to illness are back with us today. Amen. Sister Rita Oliver is back today. Amen. After having undergone surgery. There she is. Amen. 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 And we're so happy to have you back in the house. God bless you. Now, brothers and sisters, at this time, we want to prepare to come quickly with our tithes and with our offerings. Amen. We're so grateful for the members who have been so faithful in your financial stewardship by paying your tithes, giving your offerings, supporting our vision fund. Amen. Our benevolent ministry. Amen. Our Sunday school with your financial contributions. It means so much. And it enables us to continue the good work that our Father has called each of us to do. Beulah does so much for so many. Amen. We help those who are in need. And we help young people to further their education by giving scholarships to many young people each year. Also, we work to provide ministries and services for those who are in need of food, for those who are in need of clothing, and we are providing ministries for young people over in the Family Life Center each week. Amen. And so we're providing ministry also for senior citizens over in the Life Center who come to do their water aerobics. Amen. In a heated pool. Amen. And the young folk have come to me and said, Pastor, can you get them old folk out of the pool where we can please do some swimming and get our swimming lessons in? Amen. 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 All I'm trying to tell you is Beulah is doing so much for so many, not only within the family of Beulah, but all across the community. Amen. As we get ready to come with our tithes and offerings, let us go briefly to our Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you afresh. It's another day's journey, and we're truly glad about it. Thank you now, dear Father, for every blessing that you have showered down upon us, the greatest blessing of all being your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for all the doors you've opened, for all the ways you've made, for all the prayers you've answered, for all the sicknesses you healed. Thank you, Lord, for being there, dear Father, when no one else was. Thank you. And now, Father, as we come with our tithes and offerings, we know we can't repay you, but we can obey you. And we're coming in obedience to your word, dear Father, bringing our tithes and our offerings. And dear Father, bless your people now. In the name of Jesus, we humbly pray and we say thank you and amen. Amen. We want to mention, amen, special thanks to all of our online givers, special thanks to our text to give supporters, special thanks to those who take advantage of the kiosk machines in the vestibule, special thanks to those who mail in your tithes and offerings, special thanks to our friends who view these services each Sunday and who are blessed. And we want you to know that we appreciate your financial support. And if the Lord is blessing you through these services, you are certainly encouraged to help us continue the good work that our Father has assigned our hands to do. Bless now. Send in your contributions. We welcome them. We appreciate them. We need them. And we need your support. And your support will not go unrecognized nor unblessed by the Lord. Let us come now at this time, if we would all stand, following the guidance and the direction of our ushers. Amen. Let us come. fire. Thank you so much for your tithes, your offerings, your financial support. Father God, we come now thanking you again for all of your people. Dear Father, for their contributions, for their support, for their obedience to your word. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there might be meat in mine house, saith the Lord. Prove me now herewith, saith the Lord, and see that I will open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive. Bless each of them now. And throw in some unexpected blessings. Throw in some unanticipated blessings. And dear Father, we will not fall short about giving you the glory, the honor, and the praise, because it all rightly belongs to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you. And amen, amen, amen. Just before the choir comes, amen. Is Brother Sean Jenkins here? There he is. Amen. Sean has finally returned back to us here at Beulah after suffering from thyroid cancer, a stroke, and open heart surgery. It was rough, but God bless you. So good to have you back in the house. God bless you. Amen. Thyroid cancer, a stroke, and open heart surgery. Amen. Amen. Don't you tell me. Don't you tell me that the God we serve I know he's still able. God bless you. There's something about that name. The name of Jesus. Thank you, choir. His name is precious. This morning, I would that you would pray with me briefly and come with me to some verses of scripture that you will find recorded in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. Come with me first. Genesis, the 32nd chapter. And we will take note first of verses 9, 10, and 11. Genesis chapter 32. Taking note first of verses 9 through 11. And reading from the King James rendering, these words are recorded. And Jacob said, O God, my father, the God of Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saith unto me, Return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I am become two bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau. For I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother with the children. And if you'll come a little further in that same chapter, to verses 24 through 28, you'll find these words. And Jacob was left alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, Let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. And he said unto him, What is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed. For the sake of emphasis, I lift up verses 10 and 11. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now am become two bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother with the children. A man who has had a bad track record. A man who has been guilty of some terrible things. A man who has done wrong. A man who has sinned greatly. But something has happened. Years have passed, but something has happened. A change has taken place. That man, guilty of so many sinful acts, has now been made brand new. Oh, brothers and sisters, oh, I would that you would pray with me. For that man was named Jacob. Pray with me on this thought. Please don't give up on Jacob. Please don't give up on Jacob. The name Jacob has become synonymous with liar, con man, deceiver. We are informed in the book of Genesis of Jacob's wrongdoing, how he lied and deceived his blind elderly father, and how he robbed his own brother of the blessings from his father. When I speak about Jacob, Jacob that I'm speaking about in this text, is more than simply the Jacob of this scripture. I'm speaking about those people that we know who are engaged in wrong activities. People that we know who are presently traveling the wrong roads. People that you and I know. Some who are, in some cases, members of our own families. I'm speaking, my brothers and sisters, because sometimes it seems that the more we talk to them and the more we pray for them, the worse they become. And because we have done so much talking and so much praying, brothers and sisters, and we've seen no change in their conduct, no change in their behavior, no change in their wicked activities. Some of us have grown tired of talking. Some of us have grown tired of praying. And sometimes we have come to the conclusion, I'm not going to waste any more of my breath on talking to them. I'm not going to waste any more of my time lifting up prayers to God for them. We can grow tired. We can grow weary. But the Lord has sent me here this morning, and he sent me here with a great sense of urgency. He sent me here to tell you that no matter how bad your Jacobs may be, no matter how awful their behavior and conduct may be, God has sent me here with an urgent plea. Please don't give up on your Jacob. I'm sensitive to Jacob. I make no excuses for him, but I am sensitive to him. Because, brothers and sisters, none of us have been perfect. I know that sometimes there are those who try to give the impression that they have walked the straight and narrow path all of their lives, never faltering, never making errors, never making mistakes. But you and I both know that such is far removed from the truth. We may not have been as bad as some other people have been, but in a way, we have all traveled some wrong roads. We have all made some mistakes. We've all come short. We've all, on occasions, missed the mark. And oh, thus I have a degree of sensitivity for Jacob. Oh, brothers and sisters, and you need to also, yes, be sensitive concerning Jacob. Yeah. The person who tries to act holier than thou is setting up in here right now. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. From the pulpit, from the choir stand, from the deacon board, the deaconess board, the minister's spouses, even the mother's board. The Bible says, let me put it like the late Sister Lucille Walker, who was my Sunday school teacher at West End Baptist Church. She would always say, the Bible says, not me, but the Bible says, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Can I get a witness? Don't give up on your Jacob. Your Jacob may be one of your children. Your Jacob may be a brother or a sister, a sibling. Your Jacob may be some other member of the family. Your Jacob, my brothers and sisters, could be a close friend or neighbor. But what hurts you about these severe Jacobs is when you truly love them. And you see them behaving so wrongly. Yes, I must not hold you, but let me tell you, brothers and sisters, the Bible tells us about this fella named Jacob. We don't hear much about him. Yet he is a prominent figure in Old Testament scripture. Jacob. He became best known for his wrongdoing. Jacob was one of the sons of Isaac and Rebekah. Jacob had a twin brother by the name of Esau. I'm talking about Jacob. Brothers and sisters, Jacob was not the firstborn. Esau was the firstborn. And even though these brothers were twins, they were not identical. Scripture tells us that there was a big difference between Esau and Jacob. Esau was a robust, hairy man who loved to hunt, who loved to spend his time outdoors hunting. But Jacob was a mama's boy. Now, Isaac, his father, was more fond of Esau, the older brother, the hunter, than he was of Jacob. But Rebekah, the mother, was more fond of Jacob. And the Bible says that Isaac had grown old in age. And to make a bad matter worse, his eyes had grown extremely dim. In other words, he had lost his sight. He was blind. And Isaac spoke to his son that he was so fond of, Esau, and told him, he said, "Son," he said, "I want to pass the blessing on to you." It was a traditional thing in that day and time. "I want to give the blessing to you and to make you heir, chief heir, over all that I have." Rebekah overheard it. Now, I don't know whether she was somewhere eavesdropping, but she overheard it. And she was not pleased with what she heard, because she did not want Esau to receive the blessing. She wanted Jacob to receive the blessing. But I can't hold you. But oh, she called the son that she was so fond of, Jacob. And she said, son, your daddy is about to do something. He's going to pass the blessing on to your older brother, Esau. He's already told Esau to go hunting and kill a deer and bring back some venison and prepare the meat. Fix it the way daddy likes it and bring it back to me, and I'm going to eat, and then I'm going to give you the blessing. And Rebecca told Jacob, she said, you should receive the blessing. And she said, this is what we're going to do. And parents, we must be careful that we don't contribute or make contributions to our children's wrongdoing. Rebecca said, son, I want you to receive the blessing. And Jacob told her, he said, but mama, he said, my brother Esau is a hairy man. He's robust. And oh, mama, how can I possibly receive the blessing? But his mother said, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to put the hide of goats on your arms and on your hands so that when your blind daddy feels you, he'll feel the hair of the goats. And when he smells you, he'll smell that odor. And all the Bible tells us, the Bible said that Jacob came in pretending to be Esau, lying to his blind daddy, lying to his elderly, feeble father. And when Isaac questioned him, he said, come here, let me feel you. Because you sound like Jacob. But when he rubbed him, he said, even though you sound like Jacob, you feel like Esau. He said, are you Esau? And Jacob lied and said, yes, I am. Now, brothers and sisters, if I could have gotten to Jacob, knowing then what I know now, I would have told him, be careful about the lies you tell. No, the Bible tells us, to make a long story short, Isaac went on and gave Jacob the blessing. Now, later, Esau comes back. He comes back happy. He's killed a deer and he brings back savory meat and he gives it to his father, and his father says, wait a minute, who are you? And he said, I'm Esau. And all The scripture tells us, Isaac tells him, but I've already given the blessing to Jacob. And so there's nothing I can do to change that. I've already given the blessing to your brother. Let me tell you, Esau was furious. Esau was in a rage. Esau was filled with anger when he learned of the trickery, the deceit, and the lies of his brother Jacob. And he said, I'm going to kill him. I don't care if he is my brother. I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him. You think some of the things you see going on in the world now is something? Read this book called the Bible. But he said, I'm going to wait until daddy dies. And as soon as daddy dies, I'm going to kill him. Well, the mother, Rebecca, overheard that. And she ran and told Jacob, the one that she was so fond of, listen, your brother is going to kill you. And you need to leave here right away. Go down to Haran, to my brother Laban's house, and stay with him until hopefully your brother has calmed down. Scripture tells us Jacob left. Oh, brothers and sisters, I think I need to tell you something here. Let me tell you that Jacob, in his wrong and evil doings, seemed like he was a hopeless case. The first point that I want to inject is the tendency to give up on those that appear hopeless cases. Jacob appeared to be a hopeless case. Have you ever met some people, or have you ever learned of some people who appeared to be hopeless? I don't have to think long or hard . There's some that comes to my mind right away who lie and have no conscience, who lies and rallies people behind him to get with his lies, who lies, and the more he lies, seem like the more some people love him. I'm talking about people who appear to be hopeless cases. Jacob had to leave home. And let me tell you this. He left in a hurry. And all the Bible tells us, brothers and sisters, that he went over to Haran, to his uncle Laban's house, to dwell with him. He fell in love with Laban's youngest daughter, Rachel. He saw her. It was love at first sight. He wanted Rachel. Yeah. Couldn't take his eyes off of her. He went to his uncle Laban and told him, I have a desire to marry Rachel. And Laban said, all right. And the Bible tells us that the wedding was prepared and the feast was prepared. And all, Jacob went into the tent that was dark. He laid with a woman, but that morning when the light was shining, it was not the woman that he wanted. It was not Laban's youngest daughter, Rachel. It was his oldest daughter, Leah. Some Bible students know what I'm talking about. Now, Leah. You know, Leah, was she didn't look that good. And he laid with her all night thinking that that was Rachel. Jacob was upset. He was outraged. And he went right on to his uncle Laban and said, wait a minute. What in the world have you done? I told you I wanted Rachel. And I wake up and I find that I spent the night in the dark with Leah. And Laban said, well... He said, that's something I forgot to tell you. Leah is Rachel's oldest sister. And he said, the younger sister can't marry before the older sister. And so that your tent would end up not empty. So that you would at least have one of the sisters. I let you have Leah. Now Jacob had already worked 7 years for Rachel. And Laban told him, if you want Rachel, you got to work 7 more years. If I could have gotten to Jacob, I would have told him, Jacob, why in the world are you so upset? Jacob, what goes around comes around. You will reap what you sow. Can I get a witness here? Somebody knows what I'm talking about. You lied and you were a con artist. Now, you met your uncle. He's the chief con artist. But Jacob loved Rachel so much until he worked 7 more years for Rachel. And the Bible tells us that during that time, Laban would cut his pay more and more each year. But he kept on working. But now, he has heard the voice of God speaking. Is there anybody who knows God will speak to you? God spoke to Jacob and said, it's time for you to go home. It's time for you to go back home. And the Bible tells us that Jacob packed up what he had, got his two wives and the children that he had to start back home. And scripture tells us the events of this text that I read earlier in your hearing took place while Jacob was on his way back home. God is calling for somebody to come back home. God is speaking to somebody and saying, it's time for you to come home. Yes, you made some mistakes. Yes, you've done some things wrong. But it's time for you to come on back home. Jacob packed up, loaded the camels. He got his wives, his children, servants, and they started back home with Jacob. The Bible tells us that when they got near Jacob's home, Jacob got worried about Esau. How will Esau receive me? He said years ago he was going to kill me. I wonder, has his hatred for me changed? And all brothers and sisters, Jacob learned that Esau was coming. That Esau had learned of Jacob's whereabouts. And Esau was coming with 400 men. And the record tells us when Jacob learned about it, he divided his family and his camp into two parts. He sent part of his family and camp in one direction and the other in another direction. And that left Jacob all by himself. Sometimes, in order for God to work with us, sometimes in order for God to move on our hearts, our minds, and our spirits, it's necessary that we be by ourselves. He was by himself. Scripture tells us, when Jacob learned that Esau was coming, Jacob, in that place all by himself, was fearful for his life, and he cried out to God. He cried out to his heavenly Father, the Father of Abraham, and the Father of Isaac. He prays and he says, Lord, I've come back en route home all because you told me to come. And now, Lord, I've learned that Esau is coming with 400 men. But our brothers and sisters, is there anybody here who can testify? No matter who and how many are against you, if God be for you, he's more than the whole world against you. Stop worrying about these haters. Stop worrying about who is against you. Stop losing sleep over people who don't like you. Can I get a witness? The Bible tells us, let me go back to Miss Lucia. The Bible says that while Jacob was there all by himself, a strange man appeared. And that man wrestled with Jacob. And Jacob wrestled with that man who was an angel. He wrestled with him all night long. And day was starting to break. And the angel said, "Turn me loose." And Jacob said, "No, I'm not going to turn you loose until you do something for me. I'm not going to turn you loose until you bless me." Is there anybody holding on for a blessing? Oh, brothers and sisters, the Bible said that the angel caught Jacob in his thigh, in the hollow of his thigh, and Jacob was rendered crippled, and he had to walk with a limp. And all the record tells us that the angel asked Jacob, "What is your name?" And he said, "My name is Jacob." But the angel said, "Your name is going to be changed." He said, "You've been praying and talking to God, and now that you are a changed man, I'm going to change your name." He said, "Your name will no longer be called Jacob. Your name will be called Israel." Can I get a witness? And all brothers and sisters, the record tells us that Jacob found out how much God was with him. For somewhere between Esau's camp and Jacob, something happened to Esau. The Bible tells us that Esau was moved by the Lord. And the Bible tells us that when Esau made it to Jacob, Jacob had an humble spirit. He bowed down 7 times before Esau. Esau went on up to him, and rather than Esau striking him with a sword or with a knife, Esau wrapped his arms around him and embraced him with love. Can I get a witness? And oh, no matter how wrong you've been treated, God wants you to still love. Yes, love them that hate you. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them who despitefully use you. Can I get a witness? And the Bible says that the brothers came together. They were united. Can I get a witness? And oh, I wish you could have been there. Yes. When these brothers were reconciled, God wants somebody to become reconciled. God wants somebody, yes, yes, to go back into the right relationship with one another. And so the Lord told me to come here and tell you, if there was hope for that Jacob. If there was hope for the Jacob in this Bible, there's hope for the Jacobs in our lives. Ain't God all right? And oh, I thank God, yes, yes, that there's hope for Jacob. Tell people, no matter how wrong they've been, I'm not giving up on you, because God loves you more than you love your own self. Can I get a witness? And oh, as I bring this message to an end, oh, I wonder here, is there anybody in the sanctuary who's ever made some mistakes? Anybody in the sanctuary who's ever traveled some wrong roads? Anybody in the sanctuary who's ever messed up sometime? But is there anybody who can testify? Yes, the Lord didn't throw me away. The Lord kept on loving me. Well, Pastor Black, yes, Pastor Black, as you close this sermon, do you have anything to tell us at the close? I want to tell you, in the words of a song I heard, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can change, who can change anybody. Is there anybody here who can testify I've been changed? Anybody here who can testify I messed up sometime, I missed the mark sometime, but the Lord kept on loving me. And all, as I close this message, there may be somebody in the sanctuary who needs to walk out. There may be somebody in the sanctuary who needs to come to Jesus. Somebody may say, I want to get my life right with the Lord. Somebody may say, I made some mistakes, but I'm coming back to the Lord. Maybe somebody can say, Pastor, I'm already saved, but because of the mistakes I've made, I wonder, will the Lord take me back? Yes, he will. Somebody may be here who says, Pastor, I'm already a child of God, but I've been praying for God to guide me to a good church, and the Lord has spoken to your heart and has told you to walk out while you still have time. Lord, touch hearts all over this building. Let somebody walk out while they still have time. I believe if Jacob was here, he'd have no problem. God bless you, my sister. He would have no problem saying, I know I've been changed. God bless you. Come on, come on. God bless you. God bless you, my brother. God bless you. Is there another who will come? I know I've been changed. If you're in the balcony, come down either of these side stairwells. One day, I was living in sin. But Jesus came and he took me in. The angels in. Is there another? If you don't believe that I've been redeemed, follow me on down, down to the Jordan stream. Oh yeah. Is there another? Listen, he's opened doors that others couldn't see. The angels in. Oh, I tell you, come on, my brother. Oh, 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 God bless you. Let the church say amen. Any change folk in here? You're better than you used to be. Now, we would be terribly remiss if we would depart from this first Sunday service having failed to give the people of God Holy Communion. Father God, thank you for giving your son Jesus to pay the price for our sins. Father, thank you. We ask you to bless this bread, bless this wine, bless your people. Let us receive it, Lord, in obedience to your holy word. This do in remembrance of me. Bless this bread and wine. Let it achieve in each one who will receive it your perfect will. For this we ask in Jesus' name, and we say thank you. And amen. In a small chamber in Jerusalem, Jesus gave the first of what we now refer to as Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper. Why do we do it? Because his word tells us that we should do it in remembrance of him. And as often as we do it, we do show forth his suffering and his death until he returns. Now, scripture tells us that our Lord took bread and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After that, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it unto them and said, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." After that, our Lord went on into a garden called Gethsemane. There he was arrested after he had prayed to his Father. He was led on to the cross after standing trial. And there he shed his blood for you and me. Blood that will never, ever lose its power. Let us stand. Yes. The blood that Jesus shed, he shed for me. Way back on Calvary, oh church, the blood that gives us strength from day to day. Yeah. reaches. Oh, yes, it does. And it flows. To the lowest. To the lowest valley. Yes. The blood that gives me strength. As you depart, please drop your communion cups in the baskets. The officers, the ushers will be holding them. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for what you did for us. Thank you that your love for us was so awesome, so great, until you gave your only begotten Son, who also gave his life, that each of us could have life, everlasting life, and have it more abundantly. Now we pray that the grace of you, our wonderful God, the love of our blessed Savior, Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of your powerful Holy Spirit shall rest, shall rule, and shall abide with each and every one of us, now, henceforth, and even forevermore. For we pray and ask it in Jesus' name. And we say thank you, amen, amen, amen.